Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. This week, I have an amazing guest with us, Roberth Strand. So this week, we're going to be talking about what is GitOps. So tune in. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. With us this week, we have a very special guest, Roberth Strand. Hey, Robert.
Hey, April. Thanks for having me. Like I mentioned before the show, I'm kind of in not my usual habit, so we have a little more home cozy from far in the north where no one's been besides us that used to live there at least. So yeah, excited to be here. Exciting topic. It's going to be great.
It is going to be good. So today we're going to talk about what is GitOps. But before we get started, I would love for you to tell us who you are and tell us a little bit about Roberth.
Yeah, sure. So like you mentioned, my name is Roberth, and I'm a cloud architect at a company called Crayon. And I'm based out of Norway, but Crayon is a global thing. So, you know, working with customers all over the world. I do a lot of Azure things, and I do a lot of infrastructure as code and DevOps, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm also an Azure, Microsoft Azure MVP and Azure Corp Ambassador. So I'm lucky to be part of some selected few and get to be part of stuff like this.
Yeah, and I'm so glad to have you on the show today because we're both Hashi ambassadors, and that's actually how we connected. And you know GitOps really, really well. So can you start us off and tell us what is GitOps?
All right. So back in the early days of GitOps. So 2017, we had the company called WeWorks, who is known for creating the tool Flux, who kind of coined the term, right? And the term came from their operational model. So, mm-hmm. It makes sense, GitOps, right?
Absolutely.
The fun part about GitOps is it's a very popular topic. At the same time, it's a topic that people kind of don't understand the term. So they think that they're putting stuff in Git, then they automate it, and then they got GitOps because, operations and Git, cool.
Magic.
But yeah, it's magic. But WeWorks kind of went out and told people how they look at GitOps, and they have certain principles that kind of followed, and mm-hmm. everything is set so that the only way that you're supposed to do operational things is through Git. Having something in a pipeline, something react to a change in Git, that's kind of not GitOps. That's just normal DevOps. That's just normal CI/CD pipeline, right?
Absolutely.
So the idea is that instead of having something react to something in Git, or, it could be stored anywhere, you want to have that as your main, source of truth. And mm-hmm. also you shouldn't touch it besides it. Obviously there's, you break glass, something went wrong, you need to check stuff. But the idea is everything is going through Git. That's that's the main idea. So WeWorks kind of coined the term, it became popular. And obviously as soon as they kind of coined the term and people started using it for everything, they started creating materials, surrounding the things that you think are GitOps is not really GitOps. And a lot of companies, WeWorks included, and also Microsoft, went together and created the GitOps working group.
Okay.
That's under the CNCF. Mm-hmm. And they started the Open GitOps project. So that's what I have on my screen here. This side is kind of created just to talk about the Open GitOps project itself. And the idea about around the Open GitOps is to create standards, some education to help people adapt GitOps, and having that as a standardized approach. But most importantly, what happened is that we took in the GitOps principles that were kind of loosely defined by WeWorks, mm-hmm. and people said, I think this went on for like 6-7 months or something, and try to boil that down to what are the actual principles, what defines GitOps. So whenever people talk about GitOps, this is actually a definition of GitOps. So first of all, the first principle is that it's supposed to be declarative, and
yeah.
that's kind of by now a standard, right? We're doing everything declarative at this point. But it's important to have that because we don't want to define how something happens. We want to define what we want to happen, and then you can change tools, you can change workflows and everything like that, and it should stay the same, right?
So that's flexibility as well.
Yeah. So you know, you can change out the different kind of you know working parts and moving parts, but you know, if it's defined declarative, this is what we want. So the second one is that it's supposed to be versioned and immutable. And this is kind of one of the main key parts of where we kind of differentiate from what people are doing. Mm-hmm. By this, we mean that every single version that's in Git is an entire state of that system. Mm-hmm. So we talk about desired states. We want our desired state to be stored in Git or any other version controlled. It doesn't have to be Git, but you know that's what everyone's using. And it's supposed to be immutable. So every time you do a change, you actually are rewriting the entire version of that system. Even though it's a small change, you know every version is looked at as one desired state. This works because, for instance, when people are stuff happens, and, you know, mistakes happen, things go down, we need to go back. You do a Git revert. That's it. You save your entire system by going back one to the previous version that used to work.
And I think that's such a critical thing to point out to people that are watching. When you're deploying infrastructure, you make an oopsies because you accidentally deployed something, or you're tracing where something happened. To be able to revert that quickly allows you to fail fast, massive DevOps principle, but then also know and have that traceability with what you've done and having that version control and knowing going back to another working model. And it's great for testing and so many great principles there. So I think for me, that's one of the big ones is having that versioning principle in there. That's really crucial.
Yeah. And even just as a reference point to it's not working now as it should be. Why? That previously you have that, but also just having that immediately, all right, we need to go back. And everything comes back to that one desired state that actually worked. The third one is we called it pulled automatically, and that people might think that that's what they're doing, but what we're trying to get across there. So we're talking about software agents, but totally honest, it's basically operators or controllers in Kubernetes Kubernetes world. The idea here is that since we're not going to do anything manually in the system itself, we want to have some sort of software ranges that kind of pull that together and make it so. And then that kind of leads on to the fourth one, where it's supposed to be continuously reconciled. I can't even speak.
Reconciled.
Reconciled, sorry.
Those words.
Those words. That's what happens when you're not native English speaker. But anyway, so you have the software engines that look at the change and then they, make it so. And you're not supposed to touch anything of this. This is supposed to be set up, automatically. So that's kind of where it differs from having a typical pipeline thing.
And I think having the principles is really crucial. And you start at the top and talk about, best practices and standards. That's really important for people getting started as well, because we want to make sure when we start using things like GitOps or any other technology or new thing, we want to do it the right way and have those best practices in there. And following community standards, especially in an open source community, is really crucial.
Yeah, and this kind of, like I said, it kind of helps actually put GitOps in, make it something you can define. Because that's been kind of hard. And I talk to a lot of people to say, yes, we do GitOps. It turns out they have stuff in Git and they have a pipeline. So, they got GitOps. But GitOps is actually a thing that can be defined. And these are kind of the traits that define them. So I think it's really important. That's the first thing that the Open GitOps project or the GitOps working group did. And I think that's kind of sets the stage for everything that comes for along.
Cool. And I think if people want to get started, I believe there's a GitHub repo that they can go to.
Yeah. So if you want to get involved, because, we're just a bunch of people and, we need everyone involved to help this move along. You can go to the open. Well, right now it's open-GitOps. We'll see about the name. And there's a project repo here, which is open for everyone. Actually, everything's open for everyone. And here it kind of defines, what the sandbox, CNCF sandbox project of Open GitOps is. kind of points you towards all the different, you know, the high stakes repositories, so to speak, you know, helps you find out how to get involved. So it's a project under the app delivery tag in the CNCF. Yeah. And so we have kind of like these kind of like structured approach to this, and but it's open for everyone, so everyone can join and contribute and define what GitOps will be in the future, hopefully.
That is awesome, Roberth. Thank you so much for joining us today. Really knowledgeable on what GitOps is and actually defining GitOps, because you're right, there are so many people out there with different definitions of it, and they aren't always maybe the best working definitions, right? So. Yeah. Thank you so much. And I want everyone to stay tuned because we have a whole series coming on GitOps. So tune in next time for myself and Roberth, and we're going to be covering more GitOps topics.